Hello, and welcome to this introduction to the Lambda Calculus. So, what is the Lambda Calculus? It's a formal system for expressing computation based on function abstraction and application. So what does that really mean? It basically means it's a mathematical system for describing computer programs that we can reason about, we can logic about, and we can write rules to understand our programs. So, let's have a look at an example. Our example that we're going to look at first is writing an identity function. That's a function that just takes in an argument and spits it out again, being passed a 3. And so in other languages, it might look like this. So on the left, we've got some functional languages like Haskell and OCaml. In the middle, we've got JavaScript, and on the right, we've got Python. And for JavaScript and Python, the top level one is similar to a functional languages style way of writing code. And the bottom one is a more perhaps traditional way of writing those functions. Our Lambda calculus is going to look more similar to the functional languages on the left and the shorter condensed versions at the top. So what does that actually look like? It looks something like this, very, very similar to Haskell syntax. On the left, we've got this thing we're going to call function abstraction. So we're going to say here, we're going to take in an X and return an X. So this is our identity function. So we're saying the backslash X is defining, well, it takes a parameter X. We've got an arrow, and everything to the right-hand side of the arrow is a function body. And in this case, it's just an X, so it just, that basically means return X. When we look at some other programming languages to compare, we can see how this looks like. So basically the one on the left is our parameter, the one on the right is our function body where we are returning it. So taking our focus to the right-hand side of the expression, we've got this 3. We're gonna say this is a literal 3 for now, but in theory, it could be a globally scoped variable, it could be something else. There's also a way of specifying numbers in Lambda calculus using a system called church encoding, which we're not going to get into right now. That is a thing if you want to look it up. And we're basically going to say we want to apply this 3, or really apply the function on the left-hand side to the 3, and we're going to join these up in function application. So how do we do that? We do that through a process of beta reduction, when we're trying to evaluate this thing. So the 3 basically gets substituted in for the X as an argument. And then we take everything on the right-hand side of the arrow, so the function body, which in this case is just X, we then replace that with the 3, or we replace that with the argument we're passing in. So on the right-hand side of the body, we're gonna say any X is there, we're gonna replace with a 3. So if we were to actually evaluate this, we pass in the 3, that changes an X to a 3. We've just got an X, so we end up with just a 3, which is what we'd expect from applying an identity function. We just get the thing that we passed in. So going back to our expression, we can break this down into its kind of component parts, and these are going to be the key building blocks of any expression in the Lambda calculus. So this X on the right-hand side of the arrow is going to be a variable, actually. So we're just going to say that's a variable, just like you'd have a variable in another programming language. It's just a reference to an X. We've also got a 3, which could be a variable. We might say it's a globally scoped variable. In this case, we're going to say it's just a literal. It's a literal number. And then also on the left, that whole backslash X arrow, and then including the function body, is going to be our function abstraction or function definition, what you want to call it. I'm going to call it abstraction. And we're applying these two things in a process called function application. So we're applying the function to the argument or the literal we've got over there. And actually, if we look at this, and in fact, any Lambda expression, we can build a tree out of it. So at the top, we've got our application. This basically means the same thing as our expression on the left. We've got our application, we've got abstraction of that function definition. We've got our variable, which is the function body. And on the right-hand side, we've got our literal 3. So speaking of other ways of representing it, this is the syntax I've chosen and we'll be using hopefully consistently throughout this series. Haskell uses a very similar syntax where the arrow is just broken up a bit, but actually if you have a font that uses ligatures, you might get it looking like an arrow anyways. You might also see an actual lambda symbol used instead of a backslash. So the backslash is supposed to look like a lambda symbol, but it's supposed to be easier to type. The lambda symbol is a Greek letter, so that's what it looks like, you might see that. You also might see a dot instead of the arrow used for function abstraction. However, I will be using the top format consistently throughout, so hopefully that can clear up any confusion. What are the parts of this expression? So this is a Lambda expression where we've got our function abstraction, backslash x, arrow, another function abstraction inside of that, backslash y arrow, and then a variable inside of that, x, and we've got a 1 and a 2. So I've given away a bit of how this is broken down, but let's go through it. We've got our x variable, we've got our 1 and 2 literals, so kind of taking it from a bottom-up approach, that's pretty easy to see. We've got our nested function abstraction inside there, which contains our x variable as the function body, and then we've got our outer function abstraction where we bound x. And then outside that, we've got function application. And you see we've actually only applied one argument at a time. And so in our Lambda calculus, we're going to apply one argument at a time to our functions. And then you add the second argument afterwards. So we might be looking at this and saying, OK, what does it evaluate to? So let's have a look at how it evaluates. Let's compare it to a couple languages you might know, JavaScript or Python. This is effectively the same expression in those languages, just as a hint. I assume if you've done OCaml or Haskell, that this expression should be fairly straightforward to look at and just immediately see what happens. We're going to do a beta reduction where we take the 1, we're going to pass it in as x. We're going to look at what's on the right-hand side of the arrow after that x. We've got backslash y arrow x, but we're replacing all the x's with 1, so we end up with backslash y arrow 1. And that's what we get, and we've still got that 2 there. And so let's apply that 2. We put the 2 in for the y, we look at the right-hand side of the arrow, it's just a 1. There's actually no y there to replace, but if there was a y, we'd replace it with 2. But anyways, we take the right-hand side of the arrow, and that is a 1. So that's how that expression evaluates. So let's look at another example, slightly more complicated, perhaps more realistic, where we've got some variables that are named more sensible things than just x's and y's and z's. So let's break this down into the two lines. On the first line, we can pull out the variables and literals. I'm using a slightly shorter syntax, it's quite common. We're just taking the first three letters of each thing. So lit for literal, var for variable, abs for abstraction, and app for application. We're going to take those two things. We can actually see, well, that is an application there. We're going to zoom out a little bit further. We've got a abstraction over that whole thing. So actually, odd is a variable we're passing in through the function abstraction. And it's going to be defined by the argument we're passing through. So let's have a look at that argument we're passing through. That's going to be the second line. We're going to have a look. We can easily pick out all the variables and literals. We can then say, well, mod is then applied to x because they're next to each other. So that's an application. Well, then there's the 2 next to that. So that's another application. And then there's, well, equals is passed that. So that's another application. And then 1 is passed into all of that. And we've got another application. So a stack of, you know, 4 applications nested within each other. And then that whole thing is wrapped around in the big abstraction with x. And just because it's getting pretty chaotic, we're going to simplify that. We're going to say those two are the abstractions. You know, obviously, it goes deeper in that. But then between them, we've got an application. So that's what that whole expression looks like and how we've broken it down into its kind of building blocks, all those constituent parts of variables, abstractions, and applications. So let's look at that expression. We can say, okay, well, now we know the building blocks. How does it evaluate? How can we apply that beta reduction process so we can figure out what this actually means? So let's have a look. Well, it looks very complicated. You might need a while to stare at this and figure out what can we actually apply here. Well, this whole big thing is one giant function application. Remember, when we zoomed out, we found there's one big function application around all of it. So the argument of this is actually that whole bottom line, that backslash x arrow and then all of that stuff. And that's going to be passed in into that odd parameter. So we're going to look at the right-hand side of that arrow, which is odd 3. We're going to replace the odd, because that was the parameter, with the whole second line, because that's the argument. We're going to end up with this, which is slightly shorter, slightly simpler. But, you know, we're making progress. So let's have a look at this thing and try and figure out how we can simplify this. Well, here we can see it's another application at the top level. So we can take this 3. We can say, well, that 3 is going to be passed in as x. We're going to look at the right-hand side of the arrow. We've got equals mod x 2, 1. So we're going to replace the x with a 3. And so we get equals mod 3, 2, and then 1 at the end. And at this point, we might say we're done. And in many Lambda calculuses, that would be perfectly fine. We're going to say we're done. We can alternatively assume that equals and mod are defined in some global context somewhere, and that's what we're going to do here. So we're going to say mod is the modulo function, or like the remainder function, and equals is checking whether two things are equal. So we can say mod 3, 2. The remainder after 3 is divided by 2 is 1. And well, 1 and 1 are equal, so this is going to evaluate to true. That concludes our introduction into Lambda Calculus, which covered what Lambda Calculus looks like and its basic building blocks. This video is part of a wider series where we'll be building up to Hindley-Milner type inference, and the next we're going to look at understanding the grammar of the Lambda Calculus more formally. Thanks for watching to the end, and see you in the next one.